Yes. Right, good evening everyone. I think we'll give a few minutes for people to join. I think once we hit the century, we can start when we have 100 people online. Right, so good evening everyone. I think let us start as we go along. So welcome to all of you. So it's lovely to see all of you, and I wish we were really on the playground. At least to get the feel of the playground, I'm also wearing a t-shirt. I said let's now get ready for the outdoor sessions. So let's start with our journey today. I'm Dr. Srinath. I'll be taking you through some basic concepts of nephrology. We'll be just reviewing the topic. So it will be sort of a revision also, and for those who are new, it will be some sort of introduction to the nephrology and how to study that topic together, right? So let us go through that. So since we have named it DAMS Premier League, we have to have certain rules that we will follow through our quiz today so that all of you can keep a track of your score also. So all you need today is just a chit of paper to write down the score that you are going to get and see whether you are going to win the match or draw or just, you know, sort of need to push harder next time. So let's see that today, right? Great. So the rules of today's match are very simple. So in the nephrology quiz, we are going to have 15 questions. So we'll be bowling 15 balls at you. Each ball you can score 2 runs, so you have a maximum of 30 runs to score. So each question you get right, you can make your score as 2, right? So each question you get right, you score 2 runs. So you get a total of 30 points. Of course, in any match, even though it is a small over, still there will be few extras. So we let us start that opening score of each of you is already a 2. Okay, so 2 runs I'm going to give you free for all of us. So the total maximum score that you can score in today's match is 32. So how do we assess our result today? So we must know what is going to be the outcome of the match. So 24 and above, that means you have won the match. If you can get 18 and above, at least you have drawn the match of nephrology. Anything lower will tell you that you need to work harder on this topic today that we are going to discuss today. So very simple ways to keep the score, right? So all you have to answer is that be with me. There are going to be 15 questions. Then we will do some parallel discussion based on those questions, based on those topics to get an overview. And then we will close today's quiz, right? So let's get started. Right, so we hit the magic figure of 200 students are with us live. So let's start with the first ball of the day. Okay, always. So the students who know me know that I'm a very simple person, and I'm going to give you, you know, make sure that majority of you, I want all of you to win the match. So it's sort of a revision because all of you have put in the hard work. So today is just a time to take the reward. Right, so let's get started. So always in nephrology, we have to start with the physiology. So let us start with the first ball of the match today. So let us look at the question and answer accordingly. So all of you, it's a simple MCQ based question. So some of them are from our notes, just to give you an introduction of how to integrate, and questions from the DQB, which help you to consolidate the knowledge that we learn in class. So basically, for those who have not seen the DQB, I wanted to include some questions what we teach in class, and then we go on to DQB, which will help us consolidate that knowledge and make sure that we understood that concept completely. Right. So the first question is about the renal blood flow physiology. So all of us know that the renal blood flow physiology is 25% of the cardiac output. We know that kidneys are highly vascular organs. We know that the kidneys are highly vascular organs. That is clear to each one of us. The kidneys are highly vascular organs. And we know that even in the presence of low cardiac output states, even when there is a low cardiac output, so cardiac output 25% goes to the kidney. And even in the conditions when there is a low cardiac output, so if you can, so low cardiac output state is there, the autoregulatory mechanisms can help to maintain the glomerular filtration rate. So even when there is a low cardiac output state, the autoregulatory mechanisms that we have can help to maintain the glomerular filtration rate. So I have listed out the autoregulatory mechanisms. I want you to tell me which among them is the most potent. Which among them is the most potent? This is just a loosener ball. Come on. So I hope all of you are going to score on this. So I want the answer that among the various autoregulatory mechanisms, so autoregulatory mechanisms, typically they act on the microcirculation. The autoregulatory mechanisms are going to act on the microcirculation of the glomerulus. Which among them is the most potent? Which among them is going to be the most potent is the question that I want you to answer. So come on, I want few answers from you. This is just an MCQ based question, so you can participate in your chat box and give me the answer. So we all know that we have got the glomerulus. Glomerulus is the site of filtration. So in that, the glomerular vascular supply is consisting of the afferent arteriole, which branches into the capillary network, and exits as the efferent arteriole. So we have got the afferent arteriole, we have got the efferent arteriole, which form the glomerular capillary tuft. So the microcirculation, this is the glomerular capillary tuft which is there, formed by the arteriolar supply that we have. So there are few autoregulatory mechanisms which act on these arteries, arterioles, to help maintain the glomerular filtration rate. So which are these mechanisms, going one by one, and how do they work? The first one, we will name it here number A, myogenic reflex. The myogenic reflex causes prostaglandin mediated vasodilatation. The number one, I am matching with the alphabets in the MCQ option. So the myogenic reflex is a prostaglandin mediated vasodilatation. The tubuloglomerular feedback is the nitric oxide mediated vasodilatation. Which is acting on the afferent arteriole. Allowing more blood to flow into the capillary tuft. Right? But what is the important one is that it is the angiotensin mediated mechanism. The angiotensin mediated mechanism which causes the vasoconstriction. The angiotensin mediated mechanism which causes the vasoconstriction of the efferent arteriole is the most potent mechanism. Perfect. So we have got it right here. So we have started our account. So we can add 2 points, 2 runs to our credit. So all of you, great going. So this is the basic physiology question based on which we build our knowledge in nephrology one by one. So we know that the kidneys are vascular organs, and even in low cardiac output states, autoregulation helps to maintain the glomerular filtration. Even though there are multiple autoregulatory mechanisms, the most potent is the angiotensin mediated vasoconstriction of the efferent arteriole, which is the most potent in maintaining the glomerular capillary pressure. So what they do, they help maintain the glomerular capillary pressure. And that is how they help in maintaining the GFR. So even if the total blood flow is less, by allowing more blood to flow into the capillary and by reducing the outflow of blood from the capillary, it helps to maintain the glomerular filtration pressure. And that is how it maintains the GFR. Right? So myogenic reflex is maintained by the prostaglandin mediated vasodilatation. So as I have written here, A is myogenic reflex, that is prostaglandin mediated. Tubuloglomerular feedback is the nitric oxide mediated vasodilatation that occurs here, right? But the most potent is going to be angiotensin mediated mechanism, right? So that's a lovely start and a loosener ball. We have to have some simple ones also along the way. Let us make it more tougher. and get more knowledge. The whole idea is that, as I always tell all of you in class, there is nothing called tough question and simple question. These are just the questions that you don't know or you know. Whichever topic we don't know, it appears tough. Whatever we know appears simple. So I know that most of you are going to find all the questions simple, and just I'm telling you, not because they are actually simple, it's just because of the fact that you know. Once you know the topic, questions appear simple, and that will be, of course, all credit to your efforts. Right. So moving on to the next one. So let us go to the next one. So the next one, based on the same question, let us build slowly. Let us build on the concepts one by one. So coming to the next question. So the next question says that the renal blood flow, the same point is there, is about 25% of the cardiac output. Autoregulatory mechanism help maintain the GFR. But what is the most common cause of renal hypoperfusion leading to pre-renal AKI? So vascularity, absolutely important. Vascularity is absolutely important. Perfect. All of you have got it exactly right. Most important, most common is the hypovolemic state. So hypovolemic shock can be due to various reasons. Example, when the patient is having diarrhea. So in the MCQ, it can also be in the form of clinical conditions which are leading to hypovolemia. It can also be in the MCQ, it can be clinical condition leading to the hypovolemia. There can be diarrhea, there can be poor water intake, there can be burns which can lead to water loss, there can be poor oral intake. So all of these can lead to hypovolemia. Hypovolemia is the most common cause when the hypovolemia cannot be compensated by autoregulation, the patient can develop a progressive loss in the GFR. And that is what is called as pre-renal acute kidney injury. So if you look at this slide, is going to help us understand what are the various causes. What are the various causes of pre-renal AKI? The most common is the hypovolemic shock. It can also be due to cardiogenic shock. Cardiogenic shock, especially in patients with cardiomyopathy. Cardiomyopathy in patients with left ventricular dysfunction. There can be various causes. The second common cause can be cardiogenic shock. It could be septic shock, where there is endotoxin mediated vasodilatation. In the septic shock, there is endotoxin mediated vasodilatation leading to reduction in the blood pressure. And analgesic can disrupt the autoregulation, and can lead to precipitate the renal hypoperfusion. You can say that. So today the scoring, of course, depends on what you get right. But today we are also going to understand how those runs are coming to us. Right. So we are going to understand. So if the renal blood flow or the autoregulation fails, then we are going to end up the patient suffering from the pre-renal AKI, So these are the causes. Once you know the causes, I want you to learn to match it with the treatment. Once you know the causes, you can always match it with the treatment recommendation. So this is what we learn in class, that integrated approach to the topic. You don't want to memorize what is the treatment, what is the cause. You want to understand the cause and accordingly plan the treatment. So very good. So if the question comes, what will be the best first line cause? The first line treatment is always IV fluids. The first line is always going to be IV fluids. Come on. So there is a common word, clinical word. Today we are going to go clinical also. What do you mean by fluid challenge? Come on, this is our extra clinical question that we want to answer along the way. What do you mean by the fluid challenge? So now let us take one step forward. Yes, IV fluids are the treatment. Yes, but when your senior tells you or your professor tells you, give the patient a fluid challenge. What do you mean by fluid challenge? How much? Very good. Radha, you're correct. Crystalloid has to be given. How much crystalloid has to be given over how much duration to be called as fluid challenge? Very good. Excellent. So Chitra has got it perfectly right. So we want to give 1 liter of crystalloid. You want to give 1 liter of crystalloid. The most preferred is normal saline. The most preferred is normal saline. So you want to give crystalloid. Very good. You want to give crystalloid. 1 liter of crystalloid over a period of 1 to 2 hours. Over a period of 1 to 2 hours. That is defined as the fluid challenge. So when the patient comes to you in the clinical practice, comes to you in the hospital in a dehydrated state, what do we first do? We give the patient 1 liter of crystalloid. The most preferred solution is normal saline over a period of 1 to 2 hours. If the blood pressure does not improve with the crystalloid alone, so you have given the fluid challenge and the blood pressure does not improve, if there is no improvement, if the BP remains low, if the BP remains low, what can you give? For cardiogenic shock, you can give inotrope support. For cardiogenic shock, you can give inotrope support. Perfect, Kriti. Yes, correct. Perfect answer. Kriti has got it right. You give inotrope support. You always cover with a broad spectrum antibiotic. You cover with a broad spectrum antibiotic. And you will also stop any offending drug. You will stop any offending drug which can precipitate renal hypoperfusion. Which can precipitate renal hypoperfusion. Correct. So the correct answer. So you have to get the entire clinical picture. So when we study, you know, we have to be able to visualize the patient in practice. As much as we want to understand the case in the MCQ. Because I always say that, you know, before becoming MD, we always have to become a good MBBS first. And that nobody can take it away from us, no? So let us focus on that too. Along with having a good theoretical knowledge, you want to have good practical knowledge also. Very good. Very good. So, very good question. So, which are the drugs? Which are the drugs disrupting autoregulation? Which are the drugs disrupting autoregulation? Very good. One of you is correct that analgesics are there. You want to not give. There is cyclosporin derivatives, cyclosporin, ACE inhibitor and ARBs. ACE inhibitor and the ARB. Very good. Perfect. So that is why we learn now. We learn now. No, Aswati, aminoglycoside is not right. Aminoglycoside does not damage the renal blood flow. Aminoglycoside causes renal toxicity by otubular necrosis. Okay. So that's not right. So everybody, all your answers are correct. I know it is majority are from the notes, but understand them. The questions are the same and important. Aminoglycoside. What is the aminoglycoside toxicity? How is it mediated? It causes acute tubular necrosis. Come on, give me the answer why. I love these live sessions because you know that increase the breadth of our knowledge. By you interacting, we can understand it better. Very good. So how? Why? Why does aminoglycoside cause the acute tubular necrosis? What is the mechanism? We all of us know na classical example streptomycin causes nephro and ototoxicity. Why like that? Why does it cause nephro and ototoxicity? We know that, no? Very famous example. It causes nephro plus ototoxicity. It is typically nephro plus ototoxic. Why? What's the mechanism? Why only two organs should be affected? Why only two organs should be affected? Come on, you must know. Because these are beautiful history of medicine, which all of you youngsters probably are ana pare ho aap log. You are not having the privilege of having teachers who are, you know, traditionally passing on information in a story format. Ana, chalo, ek aur question puchta hu. Come on, dhyan se dekhiye, dhyan se answer kari. You know what is the concept of a drug holiday? ये आया यहाँ पर कॉन्सेप्ट ड्रग हॉलीडे. कम ऑन टेल मी, डू यू नो द कॉन्सेप्ट ऑफ अ ड्रग हॉलीडे? माइटोकॉन्ड्रियल टॉक्सिन क्लोज, बट ये स्पेसिफिकली व्हाई ओनली टू ऑर्गन्स? माय क्वेश्चन टू यू इज व्हाई स्पेसिफिकली टू ऑर्गन्स? नो, नॉट सोडियम पोटेशियम टू क्लोराइड पंप. नो नो, व्हाई स्पेसिफिकली? आप लोग बहुत लंबा लंबा फेंकते हो रे. हाँ, so you are all gone very far, you know. Pharmac class nahi hai, this is more medicine class. Drug holiday ana to reduce the toxicity. In tuberculosis we give streptomycin. You know streptomycin, how it was given? Monday to Friday, Saturday Sunday chutti ana, streptomycin Saturday Sunday chutti. Why? Because these drugs are secreted, these drugs are secreted by the tubules into the urine. They are secreted by the tubules. Yes, they are secreted by the tubules into the urine. That is why there is a 16 times concentration, 16 times concentration in the tubule and in the cochlea compared to the blood concentration. Compared to the blood concentration. No, Arshi, आप लोग mix कर रहे हो उसको. So why we want to give? Anna, welcome. So what are the points here? So aminoglycoside are typically secreted by the tubules into the urine. So compared to the serum concentration, there is 16 times concentration in tubule and the cochlea. That is why when we give streptomycin in tuberculosis, streptomycin in tuberculosis, we used to give it Monday to Friday, or we used to give alternate day regime. We used to give alternate day regime. That is how it the whole idea was. So you want to reduce the toxicity. So even though the serum level will come down, the areas which have higher concentration will be protected by giving a drug holiday. Will be protected by giving a drug holiday. Yes, very good. So this is the kind of discussion we want. I'm very happy. See, it all works only with your participation, because the questions are the same, but the outreach of the question depends on the audience. More we want to learn, more we learn together. Excellent. So we could discuss a lot of points about the auto-regulation we solved. We discussed the causes of pre-renal AKI. We discussed the treatment of pre-renal AKI. We understood mechanism of toxicity, the drugs disrupting auto-regulatory mechanisms we discussed, and we understood a little concept of aminoglycoside toxicity with the fluid challenge. Great. Perfect. Chalo. So I'm sure you scored the two runs. I'm sure you scored the two runs for the question. The answer was simple. And today I hope you also understood the reason behind that answer. Right. Great. Moving on to the third ball. Let us go to Anna. So we are all. So all the people who are joining now, good evening to all of you. So it's the DAMS Premier League Nephrology Quiz. So we have a total of 15 balls for you, I have made for you. So we will be discussing them one by one. Each ball you are going to score 2 points, and that's how we want to tally your points. Chalo, let's go on to ball number 3. Question number 3. Come on, simple one. simple one again. So I know these are simple, but the discussion is very, very important. I want you to go on, ask me how you want to discuss this further. Yes. So untreated cases of renal hypoperfusion, if you don't treat the pre-renal AKI, if you don't treat the pre-renal AKI, right? Yes. So we have got the pre-renal, if it is not treated, excellent. Everybody, Anna, everybody is going to be, I am hoping that, you know, all of you go with full marks. I hope all of you go with the full marks. Yes, correct. So acute tubular necrosis, excellent. It is the acute tubular necrosis, excellent. Pre-renal nahi hai. Most common is acute tubular necrosis. So second question mein humne discuss kiya pre-renal AKI. Now let us focus a little on renal AKI. Let us change our focus a little on the renal AKI. Renal AKI, yes. So untreated hypoperfusion most commonly will progress to acute tubular necrosis. Why? Why is important? Very good. Come on. What is the answer? Why is the hypoperfusion? Why is the tubule most prone to hypoperfusion? Why the tubule? That's the question I want you to answer. Why tubule is most prone to hypoperfusion? Why is the tubule most prone to hypoperfusion? Come on, answer this clinical question. Yes, tubule blood supply. Yes. Are no, Anna, Sakshat Shetty, exact opposite. Tubules not most active. Nahi, it is not most active. Come on, everybody. I want you to look at the physiology and answer this question. Why? Very good. Radha has got it close. Yes, tubule is important for excretion. No, least blood supply. Why? Why least blood supply? Yes. Let's try to put it together. So what's the physiology? So each nephron, each is supplied by the end arteries. Supplied by the hairpin shaped end arteries. Hairpin shaped end arteries. What do you mean by end arteries? What do you mean by end arteries? End arteries, anatomy says end arteries are the ones without collateral. Very good. Very good. So end arteries are the arteries without collaterals. That is the final path. Each nephron is supplied by hairpin shaped end arteries. But sabse pehle kaun khada hai? Glomerulus. The glomerulus, which is metabolically active. So Sakshat, most metabolically active is glomerulus and consumes 85% of the nutrition and oxygen. So it is the glomerulus. It is the glomerulus which consumes, it is metabolically active and it consumes 85% of the oxygen and nutrition from the blood. So what do the tubules receive? The tubules receive oxygen depleted blood already. They receive oxygen depleted blood already, even in normal state. Even in the normal state, they are getting oxygen depleted blood because glomerulus mota baitha hai na. Glomerulus is the fat fellow who is highly metabolically active. The glomerulus is highly active and that is why it consumes 85% of oxygen and nutrition from the blood. So from the nephron supply, glomerulus takes away most of it. So even normally the tubules receive oxygen depleted blood and that is why they are most prone to hypoperfusion. They are most prone to hypoperfusion. Please remember, most prone to hypoperfusion. So what happens they are prone to develop the tubular necrosis, and that is why tubule is also the most common site for renal AKI. Tubule is the most common site for renal AKI. Tell me a little more about renal AKI. Everybody ready? Okay, chalo. So renal AKI, what can be the points? Acute tubular necrosis, more common than acute interstitial nephritis, more common than glomerulonephritis. I have told you, glomerulonephritis is a famous topic, not a common topic. It is a famous topic, not a common topic. It is a famous topic, not a common topic at all. So, most common is acute tubular necrosis, followed by acute interstitial nephritis, followed by glomerulonephritis, followed by glomerulonephritis, followed by the glomerulonephritis. It's going to be there. Right, everybody? Little more. You want to tell me more? Acute tubular necrosis followed by acute interstitial nephritis and glomerulonephritis. Right? Chalo. Moving forward to ball number 4. Okay? I'm sure all of you have already gathered your 6 runs and 2 of extra. Hana? 8 run to aap log jama karke baithe ho. Chalo. Let us go to ball number 4. Chali. So based on this very simple, based on the physiology that we discussed, so even for a student who has just come, who has not attended the class, who has not studied, today's session itself will help them get this answer. Come on. So ball number 4, get the answer. Analgesic use nephropathy. Analgesic use nephropathy is a common problem among the elderly. So, this precipitate the renal hypoperfusion by disrupting which autoregulatory mechanism? Perfect. Myogenic reflex. Already we discussed, no? Prostaglandin mediated. Already we discussed. It is prostaglandin mediated. So, what will happen? NSAIDs affect the prostaglandin mediated mechanism. Myogenic reflex. Precipitating autoregulation. Very simple one. Right? So, bataiye. So, end of 4 balls. 10 run ho gaye. Ana? 10 on 10. How many of you are 10 on 10? I'm sure most of you are on 10 on 10. Okay? So, let's go forward. Thoda sa level padhate chalte. Okay? Let us go forward on this path further. To question number 5. Okay, read the question carefully and answer the question. It is an extension of the question. Yes, so Anubhav, very good. Anubhav is on 10 on 10. Everybody, 10 on 10. Are mere ko bahut pasand hai, hana? I love that everybody wins. Hana? The whole point is of learning is that, is to share knowledge, is to have knowledge. Come on, go on. So, analgesic use nephropathy, again, same point, I am extending this question a little more. I am extending this a little more. Is a common problem among the elderly. What are the possible mechanisms responsible for analgesic nephropathy? I am surprised to see any other answer except the one which is dominant now. Answer is D. Answer is D. All of them are possible. Anna, baki logo mein aisa kyun confusion aaya bhai? Anna, ATN or A type karne walon. Anna, what are the points? We have just built this concept, no? We are building the concepts and taking it forward. So, what do we discuss? All of them are positive. That is why analgesic nephropathy is typically called as a tubulo interstitial disorder. It is characterized as a tubulo interstitial disorder. It is a typical example of a tubulo interstitial disorder. We discussed here renal perfusion can occur. by disrupting auto-regulation. By disrupting auto-regulation, it can cause renal hypoperfusion, tubular necrosis when on chronic use. Chronic use can have long-term hypoperfusion. Long-term hypoperfusion progresses to tubular necrosis. Now only we discussed. We discussed it now only. So I want you to add the points together. Chronic use can lead to long-term hypoperfusion. Yes, so that mechanism is also possible. And interstitial nephritis, allergic response to the drug. Allergic response to the drug. One of the common offender is NSAID. One of the common offender is NSAID. Allergic response. All are possible. So, come on. I want you to tell now clinical application. Who are the patients who are high risk for developing analgesic abuse nephropathy? And what can be the precautions? Come on, tell me. So, clinical question. I want you to look at the clinical question here. So, clinical question is, what are the high risk population at the risk of developing analgesic abuse nephropathy? No. HIV patient? No. There is nothing like that. Specific? Correct. Osteoarthritis? Yes. Osteoarthritis? Maybe. Yes. We are looking at that. Rheumatology patients? Rheumatology patient. Come on. Use this background. High risk patient kon hai? Elderly. Why? Because elderly already are prone to atherosclerosis. Already are prone to atherosclerosis. They already have decreased. They already have decreased perfusion. Are logic se chaliye na. I love this, you know, among you generation, you love hi-fi answers. Maza aana chahiye na. Lymphoproliferative disorder hona chahiye. Yes. Autoimmune. I love it. I love that approach. But like, I am very old fashioned. I am looking at very basic common answers. Clinically relevant answer. तो हम लोग क्यों बोलते हैं कि why elderly is more prone? Elderly is more prone because they are already prone to hypoperfusion because they have atherosclerosis. Because they have got atherosclerosis. That is the problem number one. Number two, the person who is dehydrated. That is why we have to hydrate them. Those who are dehydrated, the person who is already dehydrated. Example, when the patient is having a febrile illness, the fever itself leads to dehydration. Fever itself leads to dehydration. Fever leads to dehydration. Yes. So, elderly population, person who is dehydrated, person who is dehydrated, takes NSAIDs for long time. They are most prone to that. So, long-term consumption. So, chronic use. So, chronic requirement. Chronic use. Classical example you have mentioned. Osteoarthritis. So, chronic use. Osteoarthritis. Chronic use. That is osteoarthritis. Is present. These are high risk population. High risk population. Yes, to some extent, pre-existing renal disease. Those who are having pre-existing renal disease are more prone to developing the NSAID associated nephropathy. Are prone to developing NSAID associated nephropathy. Migraine. Anna CB, you seem to be having lot of migraine. Aisa nahi hota re. Migraine management ideally should not be NSAIDs. If a person of migraine requires, repeated NSAID more than 2 per week, patient should be started on prophylaxis Also, the same reason, Shubhani Singh, for rheumatoid arthritis. Once you start DMARD therapy, pain should resolve. Long-term NSAIDs are not indicated. Long-term NSAIDs are not indicated. If you give them, that is wrong. But you must ideally not. You must treat the underlying disorder. So, in practice, what will you tell the patient? Suppose an elderly patient has to take NSAIDs. What will you tell? What will you tell? What should be the precaution? You must use possible and you stay hydrated through the process of NSAID use. See, allergic response is unpredictable. That is personal response to the drug. We cannot do that. So there is no problem. ACE inhibitor can be very much used. Very much used. Please remember, Kshitija Kamble, that ACE inhibitor are only problematic when the patient has renal hypoperfusion. When the patient is dehydrated, you want to stop ACE inhibitor because they will go into hypovolemia. So, can a person on ACE inhibitor take NSAID? Of course, you can take NSAID. The two are not directly related. But yes, to some extent, both of them can precipitate the same event, that is renal hypoperfusion. Both of them can precipitate the same event, that is the renal hypoperfusion. Yes. So, if there is a problem, you want to stay safe. Otherwise, no direct contraindication. Right. Chalo. Next, do ho gaya hamara. Aage chalte hain. To ball number 6. Right. Let us move forward. So, bringing us. So, how the questions in the DQB are there? They are concise, they are the summary, they are consolidation of the concepts that we learn. They are the consolidation of the concepts and the points that we learn, topics that we learn in class. So, it gives you a good revision. It can give you a good revision. So, we build up the topics in class one by one, right from physiology. You want to step it up, learn it one by one. And then we want to understand the, solve the questions so that you are perfect. Excellent, excellent. Everybody is getting right. So, option number B. Yes. So, what's the point here? So, the question you are asking, all of the statements about analgesic nephropathy are true except wala question again. True except means we want the false statement. We want the false statement. Yes. So, we already discussed now analgesic nephropathy. What is the mechanism? It can be the interstitial nephritis also. Renal perfusion also, that is a true statement. We discussed the mechanism one by one. It occurs with high dose, long term use. That also we discussed the mechanism. Once we understood the mechanism, and it occurs in elderly patient, those with pre-existing risk factor for renal disease. Those with risk factor for renal disease. Now, diabetes, hypertension also predisposes to atherosclerosis. Predisposes to atherosclerosis. But as I told you, now we will answer the point here. So, analgesic nephropathy is a tubulointerstitial disorder. It is categorized under the heading of tubulointerstitial disorder. It is categorized under the heading of tubulointerstitial disorder. Come on, quickly tell me, what will be the clinical feature? Tell me, what will be the clinical feature? I want you to answer it one by one, okay? First, clinical feature. What do you expect in a patient with analgesic nephropathy? What will be the presentation? Preserved urine output. So, there is a non-oliguric AKI. Non-oliguric AKI occurs because of preserved, no decreased. There is no decreased urine output. That's the whole point. Non-oliguric. So there is a preserved urine output in majority. Why? Because it occurs due to loss of concentrating ability of the tubules, of the tubulointerstitium. There is a loss of concentrating ability of the tubulointerstitium. So it presents as non-oliguric AKI. It presents as non-oliguric AKI is the clinical presentation. Is the clinical presentation of tubulointerstitial disorder. Now it is part of renal AKI. So tell me what you expect, Anna, what we can expect for the various parameters. I am going to ask you, it is an example, part of renal AKI. It is a part of renal AKI. Remember this point. It is a part of renal AKI. So tell me, what will you expect in this? What will you expect? Urea to creatinine ratio. What will you expect? One by one bataiye. What will you expect? Urea to creatinine ratio. Urine osmolarity. Urinary sodium and phena. Kya expect karoge? What will you expect in these? Come on, one by one. Very good. Very good. So, urea creatinine ratio will be preserved less than 12:1. Urea to creatinine will be preserved. Very good. Very good. I want you to go through the entire topic visually. Yes. It will be preserved. Urine osmolarity, dilute urine. It will be dilute urine. It will be less than 300 milliosmol. Very good. So there is less than 300 milliosmol per liter. It is dilute urine. Less than 350. Right. You can keep that. Less than 350. It will be dilute urine. Urine sodium will be minimum more than 40 milliequivalent. There will be more than 40 milliequivalent. Phena will be minimum more than 2%. Will be minimum more than 2%. Phena will be minimum more than 2%. Yes, it can be 40 also. It can be 4% also, depending on the site of the injury. Depending on the site of the injury. Perfect. So, tubulointerstitial disease finding you will get. What is the specific cast? What is the most common cast you will get? What is the most common cast you will get in tubulointerstitial disease? Granular cast in the urine. Most common is the granular cast in the urine. Muddy brown is specific for, is the specific for ATN. But overall, most common cast, excellent, yaar, excellent, you are all going, is the granular cast present in the urine. So the presentation is like that. But since glomerulus is intact, there is no hematuria. There is no hematuria. Proteinuria, even if it occurs, it will be less than 2 gram per day. Even if it occurs, it will be less than 2 gram per day. It will be less than 2 gram per day. So there is no hematuria. Proteinuria also, if it occurs, it is not common. It is rare and less than 2 gram per day. Anemia, not part of the disease. Not part of the disease. So we are looking at the urea creatinine ratio. Right? So all these points together help us understand approach to the disease in nephrology. Then you get the clinical prototype questions that we are going to solve one by one. Chalo, aage chalte hain. सो 12 रन्स प्लस एक्स्ट्रा टू 14, एवरीबडी ऑन 14, आगे बढ़ते हैं, एवरीबडी ऑन 14, ग्रेट, चलो नेक्स्ट वन. सो वन पॉइंट दे वॉन्टेड टू आस्क, यूरिया क्रिएटिनिन रेशियो, कम ऑन एवरीबडी अंडरस्टूड और नॉट? सो वॉट इज नॉर्मल यूरिया लेवल, यूरिया टू क्रिएटिनिन रेशियो, यूरिया टू क्रिएटिनिन रेशियो नॉर्मली क्या होना चाहिए? नॉर्मली इट इज लेस देन 12:1, नॉर्मली इट इज लेस देन 12:1, राइट? सो वी हैव गॉट इट हियर, लेस देन 12:1 वी आर हैविंग, नॉर्मल यूरिया क्रिएटिनिन रेशियो इज लेस देन 12:1. नाउ एक्सक्रीशन ऑफ बोथ द सोल्यूट, excretion of both the solute is proportional to the GFR, glomerular filtration rate. The excretion of both the solute is proportional to the GFR. So that is why in decreased GFR, that is renal failure, decreased GFR, that is renal failure, excretion of both the solute, excretion of both the solute is effective, excretion of both the solute is effective, and there is increase in the serum levels, and there is increase in the serum levels. So urea creatinine both will rise, urea and creatinine both will rise. So excretion of both the solute is proportional to GFR. So whenever there is a renal failure, you are going to have excretion of both solute and increase in serum level of both urea and creatinine. But what's the difference? What are the difference? What it helps to differentiate? In pre-renal AKI, in the pre-renal AKI versus the renal AKI, the pre-renal versus the renal AKI, it helps to differentiate. This is something we commonly do in practice. Look at the urea to creatinine ratio. But what happens in pre-renal, along with there is increased sodium, water and urea reabsorption from the tubule, reabsorption from the tubule to conserve the water, to conserve the water. So in pre-renal, rise in the urea is due to decreased excretion, which is proportional to GFR, which is proportional to decrease in GFR, and there is also increased reabsorption. So we can say there is a disproportionate rise, there is a disproportionate rise in the urea levels, disproportionate rise in the urea level as compared to creatinine, as compared to serum creatinine. And hence in a pre-renal, what happens? The ratio, hence the pre-renal ratio becomes more than 20:1. Hence the ratio in the pre-renal becomes more than 20:1. Becomes more than 20:1. Right, but what happens on the other side in renal AKI? Renal AKI, rise in both solute is proportional. Solute is proportional. Proportional, and hence the ratio is preserved. The ratio is preserved. Ratio is preserved. So the point is, Anurag, there are, Anna, Anurag's question is very valid. Anna, the, what if it is in between? You have to understand, in practice, the diagnosis depends on multiple parameters. So you take into account multiple parameters. So it will be helpful. It is one of the points that help you reach the diagnosis. All of them are not necessarily there. All parameters need not occur in all the disease. Anna, Anurag, remember one golden rule. Golden rule of disease diagnosis kya hota hai? That doctors read a textbook. Diseases don't read textbook. Yaad rakhna dictum. Doctors read a textbook. Diseases don't read textbook. That means all features need not be present, will not be present in each of the diseases. So you have to consider, it will not help. It will not help in the diagnosis. It will not help in the diagnosis if it is somewhere in between. It will not help in the diagnosis. Right. So is it blurred here? Is the image blurred? Then I can just restart my internet connection. Is the image blurred a little bit? No. Okay, great. So this is perfect. We are going. Okay, right. Chalo, aage bade ke aage, next one. Fine, next one. Let us go to the ball number 7. Chaliye. Right, go on. So I think it is our local, YouTube problem. It is not the range problem, it's the YouTube error. So just try that. If you can get a good range. Right. Okay, great. Go on. So number 7, we have come to ball number 7. First over khatam. Hana, at the end of first over, what is your score? Let me score after the end of first over. So, bataiye, what is your score after the first over? Kitne log kahan par khade hain? Hana, first over, 6 question ho gaye. So, aaj kitne log 14 pe khade hain? I hope everybody is on 14 only. Yes. 14, everybody. Sushmita is on 10. Come on, great. 14. Babita is on 14. Everybody, yes. So, Sushmita, 10 plus 2 extra to hai hamara. Chaliye, ek question miss ho gaya, Shubhani ka. Koi baat nahi. Radha is on 14. Yes, great. Chalo. So, 10, 12 wale hai. Anna, so, at least the start is not end. We are well on target. Anna, well on target. Krishna, 10 thoda sa backup karna hai. Chali, I hope you have added the free extras already, right? Chalo, great. Chaliye, 12. Okay, fine. Come on, move on. So, question number 7, simple one kar liya. One miss, aray yaar. Anna, you feel bad, no? One miss ka jyada dukh hota hai. Anna, 6 aa gaye, 5 aa gaye, uska to dukh nahi, khushi se jyada kya? One miss ho jana. Chali, coming. Chalo, take this run away. Hit this ball and get 2 runs easily. So very good. All of the above are possible. Yes. All of the above are possible. Yes. So, ye maine bahut important bataya. Urine analysis is one of the most underused, underrated test. It is one of the most underrated test. It gives variety of information. It is one of the most underrated tests. And I told you, you focus on basically 4 parameters. It gives a lot of information. You basically focus on 4 parameters. You focus on the protein urea. You focus on the albumin urea. You focus on RBC, hematuria. And you focus on the presence of cast in the urine. And together they are going to help identify. Probable site, probable cause and probable severity of the disease. So urine analysis, I have always told you na, urine analysis ka story aap jante ho. Ki urine analysis, when we see it the first time, how does it work? Anna, every student एवरी स्टूडेंट एमबीबीएस स्टूडेंट इज वेरी वेरी सिंसियर एंड हम जानते हैं कि यूरिन एनालिसिस इज आस्क्ड इन एवरी सिंगल पेशेंट एडमिटेड टू मेडिसिन वार्ड. एवरी पेशेंट एडमिटेड टू मेडिसिन वार्ड अंडरगोस यूरिन एनालिसिस. सो एवरी फाइल हैज गॉट द रिपोर्ट बट हम देखना क्यों बंद कर देते हैं. Why have we stopped seeing? Anna? So what are we doing? So why are we here? You know, urine analysis. What? Why do we see? So we see the report. There are many parameters, but most of the time, as medical students, we don't know what to do with those parameter. For example, likha hai protein urea 2 plus hai, granular cast hai. RBC 10 to 15 hai per high power field. But all this information, Anna, how do you understand? All this information, whether protein urea 2 plus, hematuria present, granular cast, why the student or the doctor is able to read this on the report? Not because they know medicine. They are able to read because they know English language. So don't confuse between the two. Reading the report requires knowledge of language. It is the interpretation which needs you to know medicine. So when you read the report, don't feel you are a doctor. That's because you know English, that's all. You become a doctor only when you can interpret what is given in that report. What is given in that report you want to understand. So understanding is important. But kya ho jata hai? All this information goes to the visual cortex. All this information on the report goes to visual cortex. Visual cortex passes the information to temporal lobe, memory area, and asks memory ki bhai kya karu iska main, hai na? Memory area ko poochte hain kya karu hum iska information ka kya kare. So memory bolta hai boss khali hai, no information, I don't know what to do. So kya hota hai? Impulse from the temporal, where does it go? Come on, where does it go? Impulse from temporal goes to the frontal lobe. Emotion, dil pe dukh pahunchta hai. Because I can assure you, everybody, every single student on the medicine ward round lete ho na, professor bahut kuch bolte hain, bahut kuch hame nahi samajhta. But agar puchoge ki sir ye kaise hua, to jawab mein kya milta hai? Abe बेसिक भी नहीं आता है तुमको, है ना? इंसल्ट पे इंसल्ट मिलता है हमको, है ना? कि व्हाट वी आर टोल्ड बेसिक भी नहीं आता, है ना? फिर तो दुख होता है यार, बेसिक बोला, है ना? बेसिक बोला, कम ऑन, इतना तो इंसल्ट नहीं, बर्दाश्त नहीं होता हमसे भी. सो व्हाट हैपेंस इज दैट नेक्स्ट टाइम व्हाट वी हैपेंड वी गो बैक, है ना? हम बोलते हैं, एनालाइज करते हैं कि तेरे को दुख क्यों पहुंचा फ्रंटल लो, व्हाई डिड यू फील बैड? बिकॉज टेम्पोरल ने बोला तेरे को कुछ नहीं आता. टेम्पोरल को किसने बोला कि तुझे कुछ नहीं आता है? विजुअल कॉर्टेक्स ने बोला. विजुअल कॉर्टेक्स को किसने बताया? वो यूरिन रिपोर्ट पढ़ने वाले इन आंखों ने बताया. हाउ कैन वी स्टॉप फीलिंग बैड नेक्स्ट टाइम? आइडियली यू मस्ट गेन इंफॉर्मेशन, बट वी डू बेटर, हम रिपोर्ट देखना ही बंद कर देते हैं. The moment you stop seeing the report, you start feeling well, है ना? You start feeling well because देखा ही नहीं तो क्या फर्क पड़ता है? All becomes well, है ना? But that's the problem we want to do. I always explain in all our classes, है ना? Assessment method interpretation. Assessment method interpretation is most important. It is most important. And without that knowledge, it is never going to be enough. And that is what is lacking. I'm telling you, problem is not that we are not going to medical college, but after finishing MBBS, why are we not confident of practice is because of all these things. That we are not taught so-called basics. We are not taught so-called basics. And I want to tell each one of you, please do not confuse basic with congenital. Anna, professor ko main bhi bolna chahta tha as a medical student, boss, it might be basic, but basic is not congenital. Paidaishi knowledge nahi hai na, sikhana to padta hai fir bhi. Anna, but that's where we are lacking, right? So move on. So correct answer, you have scored 2 runs. But I hope you also understood the importance of understanding interpretation. So come to the question. How do we learn interpretation? Let us see this interpretation. Interpretation at ball number 8. So we must know the presence of RBC in the urine is hematuria. Presence of RBC in the urine is hematuria. But the question is, do all of them need further test? Do all of them need further testing? Yes or no? Do all of them need further testing? Yes or no? Anna, do all of them need further testing? So answer is no. All of them don't need testing. Testing is indicated. Further evaluated. Further evaluation. Further evaluation only if it is significant. Only if it is significant hematuria. Only if it is significant hematuria. So further analysis is indicated. Further analysis is indicated only if there is a significant hematuria. Correct answer. Anna? So more than 3 occasion. Anna, but technical level pe actually ye correct hi hoga. 3 or more occasions. Anna, ideal answer kya hona chahiye? Ideally it should have been 3 or more occasion. What does 3 or more occasion should be the correct answer. Anna, so there should be correct answer. So we must know, Anna, so option number B is there, but more than 3 is same as more than 2. Ye equally hai na? 3 or equal. Yes, B is correct. B is correct. Very good. So this is also true statement and true statement. So correct answer is none of the above. All are significant. B is also correct. Sirf word change kar diya. Word kaisa change kiya? Notes mein likha more than equal to 3. तो more than 2 को हम wrong mark कर देते हैं, अबे ऐसा नहीं है, है ना, more than equal to 3 is equal to 3 also, so as long as more than 2 occasions, more than 2 becomes 3 or more than 2 automatically becomes 3 or more, that also is a true statement, that means all are correct, है ना, ये googly question, है ना, this was our googly question, है ना, I hope you got it right, but look at it very carefully. It is same, no? More than two means 3 or more. More than 2, not 2, means more than 2. It is equal to 3 only. More than 2 is equal to 3 only. Anna, wrong ho gaya. Koi baat nahi. Anna, ye kya technical error pe? Aisa lagta hai ki humne hit wicket. Are wah, Pandey ji, aap to matlab best. Anna, Dr. Pandey has given a very good word, hit wicket. Anna, so, LBW ho gaya. Arre, baap re. Anna, okay, great, great. So, I think, you know, I'm very happy, huh? But even the, are the girls also coming up with some cricket analogy or is it only the boys? Theek hai, chalo. So, correct answer hai, none of the above. Ek bar quickly dekhiye. Anna, it's quickly ek bar dekhiye. Haan. So what's the point here? That confirm significant hematuria. Ek bar dekh lijiye. Just you go through with the approach with me. So if you have hematuria, first step is to confirm significant hematuria. First step is to confirm significant hematuria. So if it is gross hematuria, more than 100 on single occasion, more than 3. But less than 100 on 3 or more occasion is also considered significant. 3 or more is going to be considered significant. What do you do? So what do you do? If it is significant hematuria, you categorize into 2. It helps identify based on the RBC morphology, helps identify the probable site of the disease. helps identify the probable site of the disease. It is going to tell you, helps identify the probable site of the disease. Yes, everybody, correct. So if the RBC morphology is normal, more common is eumorphic. More common is eumorphic. If more common is eumorphic, it is suggestive of collecting system. Yes, it is suggestive of collecting system defect. Collecting system defect, you can see. So causes are most common: urinary infection, calculi, coagulopathy, carcinoma bladder. But if it is dysmorphic, which is rare, it can indicate glomerulonephritis. Most renal, most common is not renal, it is, yes, post renal. Yes, very correct. So collecting system is typically post renal in a way. Yes, collecting system, post renal problem. In a patient with glomerulonephritis, what will we do further? What will you do further? Look for complement levels. Look for complement levels. So what do we do for complement levels? Brings us to ball number 9. Come on, give me the answer. Tell me, are you going to score on this or not? So serum C3 level is persistently low in the following except. Serum C3 level is persistently low in the following except. Come on, persistently low in the following except. So we are looking at the single best answer, because in class I told you persistently low is characteristic of lupus nephritis. Means characteristic of lupus nephritis. Characteristic of lupus nephritis. Membranoproliferative MPGN. The causes include chronic infection, autoimmune disease, and malignancy. Includes infection, autoimmune disease, malignancy. Hence, it can also be present. Post streptococcal is rare but possible. So, single best answer is IgA nephropathy. Single best answer is IgA nephropathy. Single best answer is IgA nephropathy. So sunny Texas, hematuria versus hemoglobinuria. You have to just look for RBC under the microscope. Hematuria, you get RBC. In hemoglobinuria, there is no RBC. Hemoglobinuria will not have RBC. Hemoglobinuria usually leads to tubular necrosis, because hemoglobin is a strong oxidative agent. Causes the tubular injury you will get. So hemoglobin is positive, but RBC is not. So in this question, single best answer is IgA nephropathy, though ideally best single answer would have been lupus nephritis. So what do we see? If the patient has dysmorphic hematuria, we take it further. If there is a low complement level or normal complement level. Normal complement level is IgA nephropathy and Henoxylon purpura. Normal complement is IgA nephropathy, Henoxylon purpura. Yes, IgA nephropathy is same as Berger's disease. Yes. So typically, what do we say? Yes, I am explaining that for you. So what happens here? When you get a low complement level, you repeat after 4 weeks. If it is persistently low, or if it returns to normal. Persistently low or returns to normal. persistently low is characteristic of lupus nephritis. It is characteristic of lupus nephritis. But in majority, post-infective causes, post-streptococcal glomerulonephritis, subacute bacterial endocarditis, and hepatitis B, the complement level can initially grow and returns to normal later. It returns to normal after 4 to 6 weeks. But in rare cases, their complement level can be persistently low. Rarely, they can be persistently low. So, if it is present, it helps differentiate. But they may have persistently low complement levels. Okay, chalo. Good evening, everyone. Moving on to the next one. So, we have come to ball number 10. Come on, ball number 10 pe aa jaate hain. So, ball number 10 we have got here is nephrology. Further urine analysis is got following matching of the cast. Hyaline cast, which is incorrect. Very good. Excellent answer C. Add 2 runs. So, everybody, add 2 runs to your credit. Very good. Chalo. Perfect hai. 2 run aur ban gaye aapke. So, we have got the right answer. So, what is the list of the cast we have got here? Hyaline cast is the most benign cast. But why? What it is? It is why it is the most benign. Why it is the most benign? Because it is the only cast. It is the only cast where no further test or treatment is needed. That is why it is the most benign cast. Muddy brown cast is specific for tubular necrosis. Granular cast, already discussed, most common in tubulointerstitial disease. But wrong answer. Vaxicast is seen in advanced CKD. While interstitial nephritis comes with eosinophiluria. Eosinophiluria is specific because it is suggestive of allergic response to the drug. Because 95% cases of AIN are drug induced. 95% cases of AIN are drug induced. Add 2 points to your score. Add 2 runs to your score. Correct answer is option number C. Take it forward. So question number 11. Ball number 11. Based on the concepts we learnt now. So let us see. 49-year-old woman is admitted for past 10 days with bronchopneumonia. So tell me, what are the antibiotic for bronchopneumonia? What is the antibiotic you give for bronchopneumonia? What antibiotic you are going to give? Definitely for bronchopneumonia, you are going to consider extended spectrum fluoroquinolones. Are you admitted? Admitted means moderate. Admitted patient. In admitted patient, azithromycin, that is for OPD. But in an admitted patient, you want to give extended spectrum fluoroquinolone with amoxiclav or third generation cephalosporin or third generation cephalosporin you want to give. So in an admitted patient, now change according to the point, no, abhi theory khatam. So doxy and all will come when the patient is OPD basis. But when patient is admitted, you are going to give extended spectrum fluoroquinolone, amoxiclav or third generation cephalosporin. She developed the onset of fever over past 2 days. Peripheral smear shows eosinophilia and eosinophiluria. Eosinophiluria is indicating what? Interstitial nephritis. It is suggestive of interstitial nephritis. Option number C. Very good. Option number C. Yes. So what are the drugs which are prone for? Common drugs associated with acute interstitial nephritis. See, we are connecting the whole topic together. All these are discussed in today's session only. We can find so many answers. Common offending fellow in clinical practice is NSAID. Common offending fellow in the clinical practice is NSAID. Allergic response. Of course, you are correct. Sulfa agent, penicillin are prone to allergy. But cephalosporin is not also 100% safe. It can also add to the point. Respiratory antibiotic, fluoroquinolone, rifampicin can lead to problem. Yes, you have got nitrofurantoin used in uncomplicated UTI. Contrast agents can lead to acute interstitial nephritis. Pentamidine, Rajlakshmi. Pentamidine is only present in pharmacology textbook. Pentamidine never came to India. And it came as a nasal spray, but toxicity is high. It never survived in clinical practice. So yes, there is a difference, no, between pharmac textbook and medicine textbook is what becomes practical, what becomes approved comes into practice. Yes, herbal medicine, very good. Never forget. Very good. Herbal medicine, never forget. Yes, I totally agree. History should always be asked. Anna Aswati, right. In practical terms, yes. But how it is in today's generation, it is best not to mix the two. Mixopathy nahi karne ga. We should stick to medicine only. We should not blame them. They should not blame us. All is well. Anna? Aisa we have to look at it. So, but yes, clinically, we must take history that potential toxicity can occur. Yes. So, I hope you got it right. Option number C. Come on. Last ball of second over. Very simple. Come on. Are Thomas Shelby, you will be banned, huh? Just for writing the name now. Come on. Ashu is not stopping. Come on. Next one. Chalo. Which is the worst finding in the urine analysis? We just discussed it. Perfect, everybody. Perfect. Broad vesicast. Very good. Broad vesicast. I'm very happy. Very good. Why broad vesicast? We wrote it that it is seen in advanced CKD. But why? Why it is most worst finding? Because it indicates irreversible. Because it indicates irreversible tubular damage. Yes, tubular breakdown. That is why, how I remember it? Ghost of the tubule. How do I remember it? Ghost of the tubule. How do you remember it? Ghost of the tubule. You remember it as. It is the ghost of the tubule. Chalo, great. Hana? So, ghost of the tubule hai hamara. Ghost of the tubule. So, ghost of the tubule, because the tubule is dead. So, it just is cylindrical, hollow cast. It is cylindrical, hollow shape of the tubule. Cylindrical, hollow shape of the tubule. Shape of the tubule is present. Very good. So, boliye, end of the second over. Hana, end of the second over. Kahan par khade ho? Maximum score possible. 24 plus 2 extra. Kahan par ho aap log? अपना अपना स्कोर देखो कहां पर आए हो. सो वेरी गुड. आई होप पास द टेस्ट. सुष्मिता इज रिलीव्ड. चलो 18 हो गया है ना. ड्रॉ तो हो गया. मैच हार नहीं सकते. सो यू मैच्योरिटी ऑफ यू नाउ कैन नॉट लूज द मैच एनी मोर. 24 चलो तोड़ दिया. एक्सेलेंट. वेरी गुड वेरी गुड. चलो गुड 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 गुड. सो वी आर ऑल कमिंग क्लोज. वेरी गुड. सो नाउ मोस्ट ऑफ यू definitely draw in nephrology. Nephrology is going to be your good subject, na? Good match. It is like your home ground only. Don't worry. So just if you read the notes, do DQB, nephrology is going to be only victorious. Hana? Iske bahar kuch nahi hai. Aage chalte hain. Question number 13. Chalo. Ball number 13. Ye thoda sa scoring. Jo log 18 pe hain. Hana? Those who are feeling bad. Come on. Let us go further to what is the most common bone disease in CKD. Very good. Osteitis cystica fibrosa. Very good. Osteitis, sorry, Raj Lakshmi, that has changed. Probably aapne pehle dekha. The correct answer is D. Correct answer is D. Sunny, no. Wrong. Aikash, no. Anna, C nahi hai. Correct answer is D. Osteitis cystica fibrosa. What are the mechanisms? So, what is the point here? Metabolic bone disease in CKD occur only when there is 6 months. That means only in CKD. 6 months duration of the disease. That means they do only in CKD. Only in the CKD they perform. Yes. So what are the mechanisms? Osteomalacia due to vitamin D3 deficiency. It can occur. Adynamic bone disease due to remodeling bone defect. Due to remodeling bone defect. Remodeling bone defect. Osteitis fibrosa due to secondary hyperparathyroidism. Secondary hyperparathyroidism, which can cause cystic lesion in the bone, which can cause cystic lesions in the bone. That is why it is the most common metabolic bone disease. Most common metabolic bone disease. Yes, perfect. ये आप मेरे को बताना है ना. व्हाट आर द वेरियस मैकेनिज्म्स ऑफ बोन डिजीज. चलो क्लिनिकल क्वेश्चन. क्लिनिकल क्वेश्चन पूछूंगा. ओके क्लिनिकल क्वेश्चन. क्लिनिकल बेस्ड क्वेश्चन ऑन मेटाबॉलिक बोन डिजीज है ना. प्रैक्टिकल क्वेश्चन. इन अ पेशेंट ऑफ सीकेडी हु प्रेजेंट्स विथ बोन पेन्स. In a patient of CKD who presents with bone pains, name all the drugs. What are the points you want to treat? You tell me. Hana, most common ye sab kya theoretical hai. But in a patient with this CKD, which of the following drugs will be given? What are the treatment recommendations? What are the treatment recommendations? I want you to write. That is based on the पैथोलॉजी। यस सब लोग देखो अभी शुरू एक एक करते हैं। विटामिन डी कैल्शियम करेक्ट होगा। सोलेंड्रोनिक नो, सोलेंड्रोनिक एसिड इज कॉन्ट्रा इंडिकेटेड, याद रखना प्लीज। बिस्फोस्फोनेट इज कॉन्ट्रा इंडिकेटेड इन रीनल फेलियर, कॉन्ट्रा इंडिकेटेड इन रीनल फेलियर। अरे बाप रे, इतना बिस्फोस्फोनेट नहीं। क्रिएटिनिन मोर देन 1.5 होगा तो मत देना भाई। बिस्फोस्फोनेट इज कॉन्ट्रा इंडिकेटेड इन रीनल फेलियर। यस यस वेरी गुड। नाउ यू आर कमिंग। सिनाकैल्सेट, सेवलेमर, वेरी गुड। सो फॉर दैट ओनली लुक एट द मैकेनिजम्स, लुक एट द मैकेनिज्म्स, अंडरस्टैंड दैट। व्हाट आर द मैकेनिज्म्स? वन, बिकॉज ऑफ हाइपोकैल्सीमिया देर इज अ सेकेंडरी हाइपर पैराथायरॉयडिज्म। यस बट व्हाट आर द कॉजेज ऑफ हाइपोकैल्सीमिया? वन, न्यूट्रिशनल डेफिशिएंसी। नंबर टू, डी3 डेफिशिएंसी। डी3 डेफिशिएंसी इज प्रेजेंट एंड फॉस्फेट एक्सेस। व्हाट हैपेंस व्हेन द फॉस्फेट इज एक्सेस? फॉस्फेट इज एक्सेस, द एक्सेस फॉस्फेट बाइंड्स टू द कैल्शियम, बाइंड्स टू द कैल्शियम एंड कॉजेस हाइपोकैल्सीमिया, कॉजेस हाइपोकैल्सीमिया। सो हाइपोकैल्सीमिया हैज गॉट वेरियस कॉजेस। ऑस्टियाइटिस, सिस्टिका फाइब्रोसा वी हैव रिटन, सो इट कॉजेस मल्टीपल प्रॉब्लम। ए डायनेमिक, पुअर वेट बेरिंग, पुअर वेट बेरिंग इज कॉजिंग, पुअर वेट बेरिंग इज कॉजिंग रीमॉडलिंग बोन डिफेक्ट, रीमॉडलिंग बोन डिफेक्ट लीडिंग टू ए डायनेमिक बोन डिजीज, दैट वी हैव रिटन, ए डायनेमिक बोन डिजीज। सो वॉट ट्रीटमेंट शुड यू इंक्लूड? सो ट्रीटमेंट ना होलिस्टिक होना चाहिए। होलिस्टिक ट्रीटमेंट में क्या क्या इंक्लूड करेंगे? होलिस्टिक ट्रीटमेंट में यस, पहले न्यूट्रिशन, यू विल गिव कैल्शियम प्लस विटामिन डी3 सप्लीमेंटेशन, वेरी गुड। यू मस्ट करेक्ट हाइपरफॉस्फेटीमिया, फॉस्फेट लोवरिंग थेरेपी 100% देना है, फॉस्फेट लोवरिंग थेरेपी यू वॉन्ट टू गिव, वेरी गुड। यू वॉन्ट टू एंकरेज फिजियोथेरेपी, यू वॉन्ट टू एंकरेज फिजियोथेरेपी एंड दैट इज हाउ यू कैन गिव द ट्रीटमेंट, दैट इज हाउ यू विल मिनिमाइज एनसेड अब्यूज, यू विल मिनिमाइज द एनसेड अब्यूज। बिकॉज प्लीज अंडरस्टैंड, इफ द पेशेंट इज इन पेन दे विल टेक पेन किलर, इफ द पेशेंट इज इन पेन दे विल टेक पेन किलर एंड दैट यू डोंट वॉन्ट। सो यू मेक श्योर, यू टेल देम जस्ट गिविंग कैल्शियम, दैट इज द वर्स्ट थिंग, यू नो आई डोंट लाइक दैट इन प्रैक्टिस। मेनी पेशेंट जस्ट रिसीव कैल्शियम, दैट्स नॉट इनफ। कैल्शियम इज वन ऑफ द ट्रीटमेंट ऑप्शन, वन ऑफ द ट्रीटमेंट ऑप्शन। चलो नेक्स्ट एक क्लिनिकल क्वेश्चन। आप लोग जानते ही हो दिस विटामिन डी3, वॉट डू यू थिंक? इंजेक्शन एरेकिटॉल है ना, ये तो आपका फेमस है ना, एरेकिटॉल, यस और नो इन सीकेडी? इंजेक्शन एरेकिटॉल, यस और नो इन सीकेडी? कम ऑन, गिव द आंसर। सो वेरी गुड, ट्रीटमेंट शुड बी मल्टी फैक्टोरियल। सो दिस प्रैक्टिकल क्वेश्चन, चलो बोनस क्वेश्चन पूछो। एरेकिटॉल सबने सुना है, सब लोग देते हैं ना इंजेक्शन एरेकिटॉल 6 लाख यूनिट, यस और नो? यस और नो, वेरी गुड, वेरी गुड, आई एम वेरी हैप्पी। राजलक्ष्मी, प्रिंस, राधा, चित्रा, लक्ष्मी, यस परफेक्ट। नो 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 नो, बिकॉज इट इज इनएक्टिव फॉर्म, इट इज द इनएक्टिव फॉर्म ऑफ विटामिन डी, रिक्वायर्स द किडनी, वेरी गुड, आई एम वेरी प्राउड ऑफ यू, रियली वेरी प्राउड ऑफ यू। आई वॉज एक्सपेक्टिंग अ यस फ्रॉम मेजॉरिटी, है ना, बिकॉज इंजेक्शन इंडियंस लव, इंडियंस लव इंजेक्शन, बट यू डोंट गिव देम अननेसेसरली, वेरी गुड, आई एम वेरी हैप्पी। इट इज द इनएक्टिव फॉर्म, नॉट इंडिकेटेड, नॉट इंडिकेटेड, यस करेक्ट आंसर, वेरी गुड। सो वी हैव कम टू द last ball of the day today, last ball of the match today, with a question on the famous topic glomerulonephritis. So last topic of the day, last ball of the day, let us see what was the topic of glomerulonephritis. Topic of glomerulonephritis. Chalo, take the two runs here. Last ball hai. Don't miss it. Hana? So what are you looking at? When a 30-year-old male presents with hemoptysis and RPGN, what is this presentation called? Pulmonary renal syndrome. It is called as pulmonary renal syndrome. When the patient has both lung involvement and glomerulonephritis. When the patient has lung involvement plus glomerulonephritis patient has a history of smoking, renal biopsy shows linear deposit. Which is the disease? Yes, specific for good pasture syndrome. But which alpha subunit? Alpha 3 subunit. Correct answer is option number C. Dhaval Patel, thoda sa miss ho gaya. Hana, B nahi hai. Correct answer is C. Lung involvement plus glomerulonephritis. When it occurs alone, only two organ involvement. Please remember, only two organ involvement is classical good pasture syndrome. But along with this, if you get any other organ involvement, example, patient is having a skin rash, patient is having a uveitis, please suspect ANCA positive vasculitis. Correct. So correct answer is C, alpha 3 subunit of type 4 collagen. But if you get other organ involvement, definitely you will consider ANCA positive vasculitis. Right? So let us look at the immunofluorescence pattern just for revision. Let us have an image review, immunofluorescence pattern. Let us go through. So these are our granular immunoglobulin deposit. So just go through an image review. Granular immunoglobulin deposits is seen in membranoproliferative. Don't make the difference. This is the mesangioproliferative gene. Remember this. Not membranoproliferative. This is different from MPGN. This is different from membranoproliferative. Don't make this mistake. This is different from membranoproliferative. That is MPGN. MPGN mat bolna. Mesangioproliferative. It is different from MPGN. MPGN is membranoproliferative. Wo galat hai. Ye galat hai. Hana? Different hai. So granular pattern, granular immunoglobulin deposit is seen in mesangioproliferative gene. If there is predominantly IgA deposit, IgA nephropathy. Predominantly IgG deposit favors diagnosis of PSGN. So both syndromes are included under the topic of mesangioproliferative gene. But depending on which staining is predominant, you can identify the final diagnosis. Next one. The question which was asking you, yes, PSGN also called starry sky appearance. Deepika, yes, correct. What is the next? Linear immunoglobulin deposit. just like an outline, we said classical of good postures, classical of good postures syndrome. Yes, classical of good postures syndrome. Yes, so classical pulmonary renal syndrome. Good posture is a classical pulmonary renal syndrome where only two organ involvement occurs. Where only the two organ involvement occurs, not many more, only the two organ involvement occur. Right? Only two organ involvement occurs. So patient comes with hemoptysis due to alveolar hemorrhage and nephritic syndrome with a very high risk of RPG. Nephritic syndrome with a very high risk of RPGN, that is linear pattern. Last is the Posse immune pattern seen with vasculitis syndromes. Posse immune pattern seen with vasculitis syndrome. Posse immune pattern seen with the vasculitis syndrome. Yes. So smoker relations, smokers, they have got an increased risk of lung involvement. Exact reason is not known. Smokers have increased risk of lung involvement. Exact reason is unknown. But remember, so I want you to have a visual impression of these slides. There is granular pattern. There is a linear pattern. There is a Posse immune pattern. And finally, what is there is the mesangiocapillary pattern. The final one, this is the mesangiocapillary pattern. It is the mesangiocapillary pattern. Mesangiocapillary pattern is the final one. And mesangiocapillary with C3 deposit is typical of MPGN. Now it is also called C3 nephropathy. So C3N, it is also called as C3 nephropathy. Mesangiocapillary deposits, MPGN, membranoproliferative. This is also called membranoproliferative. Also called membranoproliferative. Yes, C3, other type, rare one is dense deposit. Rare one is dense deposit. C3 is the most common. C3 is more common type. MPGN, C3 is more common type. Rare is dense deposit disease. MPGN, more common is C3. Rare is dense deposit disease. As I told you already, it can be seen in infections, chronic infections, autoimmune disease, solid organ tumor, and lymphoproliferative disease. It can be seen in infections, autoimmune disease, solid organ tumors, and lymphoproliferative disease. Again, it is a rare cause of GN, but it is very important for MCQ. It is very important for our entrance exam. Yes, double track appearance of the glomerular basement membrane. Right? So we started with renal physiology and we ended our match with glomerulonephritis. Glomerulonephritis. So it is the stain is general on the background staining. That is the background staining. Krishna Prasad and previously also question, in Posse immune pattern, there is a background staining. If you look at it carefully, you get the glomerular shadows are empty. No stain in the glomerular areas. Right? Very good. So most coming to the most pertinent question, Which topic tomorrow? So tomorrow also we have got Chennai Super Kings only. So today I am having double. I am representing both Chennai and Mumbai Indians. So I have become Pan India now. So tomorrow we have got microbiology. Tomorrow we have got microbiology by Surya sir. So make sure you are on time. Make sure you are on time because sir is always on time. Because sir is super on time. Sir is super, super, super on time. Okay. So make sure you are there and have a lovely, lovely, lovely time. Okay. So I hope you all scored very highly and also, you know, enjoyed the journey of how it goes. Right. So in this DAMS Premier League, our whole idea is to help you revise the topic, get you to, you know, understand how to use the notes, how to look at the GQB, you know, DQB and go with that. Right. So lovely everyone. Okay. So we are going to. Right there, I'm not able to see the chat, so.